Hello, everybody. My name is Eric D. Johnson. I also know Brian Shine. I live right here in the city of Memphis. It's in the county sheriff. It's in the state of Tennessee. Today's date is early Sunday morning, May the 13th, 2018, time 4:50 a.m. First, say thank you to all my fans, my support, for your continued encouragement and support. I'll continue to keep myself employed right here in this city, in this Memphis tri-state area. I'll continue to further my education. Monroe College online. I'm pursuing my associate degree, studying business administration and concentration marketing. At this present time, I just took a break from going to school, but in the very near future, I will be going back to Monroe College online. I'm going to continue to pursue my associate degree in business administration and concentration marketing. And what I'm doing right now, I'm doing my Instagram. Hello, everybody. My name is Eric D. Johnson. I'm also known by Shine Day right here in the city of Memphis. It's in the county sheriff in the state of Tennessee. Today's date is early Sunday morning, May 13, 2018, time 4:50 a.m. First, say thank you to all my fans, my support, for your continued encouragement and support. Anti-gang. Now, these are just some of the a few of the websites you can go to. They make free logo design, and you go to these websites and you can make anti-gang logos. Well, first, I always give thanks to God for all the blessings and guidance that He provides us all with. Now, we're going to continue to speak out and complain about this nonsense. It's, talking about you want to be a gangster and a mobster and you want to be a thug and you want to be a goon and you want to be a boss and, you know, all this criminal. In other words, you want to be a criminal. And it's going to lead to anti-gang demonstrations, anti-gang protests. And we're going to continue to stand for what's right. Now, excuse me. we encourage myself as well as others, encourage each and every one that's listening, watching my Instagram video. Read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Now, the International Bill of Rights, Bill of Human Rights, and also the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. Declaration of the Rights of the Child. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. And we also know the history of Amnesty International. We know the history. It was a lawyer in the United Kingdom, and there were two students, Portuguese students, protesting. We know the history of Human Rights Watch, Helsinki Watch, and so while we continue to build the momentum for anti-gang demonstration, anti-gang protests, Because it's coming, it's coming. All these Fortune 500, S&P 500, all these businesses, multinational corporations, businesses, the sorority and the fraternities, you know, they pretty much involved in the crimes that are being committed. When you see all the organizations, anti-slavery, international, the International Federation for Human Rights, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, Bird Life International, Fauna and Flora International, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, and also the World Wildlife Fund. When you see all these organizations, and they're not the only ones out here, trying to stop all these crimes from being committed, human rights violations, environmental violations. Just who do you think is behind all the, you know, who is perpetrating these offenses? I guess just one person just doing all this. It's just one person that keep doing all this. No, it's not no one person. It's a whole lot of criminals. It's a whole lot of criminals. And they try to make me, as well as all of you who are listening, watching, to be criminals. As, you know, for example, the sorority and the fraternities, they be in the school from kindergarten all the way to 12th grade. They be in the school, to, you know, the school teacher, the sorority and the fraternity. They be around children in the school. And they try to influence the children to be criminals. Now, you can try to disguise it through education, but no, you're not fooling anybody by being in a classroom with children, being a member of a sorority and a fraternity. You're a criminal. And you're doing the same thing to the children. You're trying to be to influence those children to be a criminal just like you. That, you know, for example. And so the sorority fraternity, they work for these Fortune 500, S&P 500, multinational businesses, corporations, companies, whatever. And commit all these human rights violations, all these environmental violations. That's what we're doing. It's the sorority and the fraternity. So we're going to continue to speak out and complain. And it's going to be anti-gang demonstrations, anti-gang protests. And I encourage everyone that's watching, listening, watching my Instagram to also watch my Periscope, my Facebook Live, my YouTube videos. Anti-gang logos. What I'm doing now, I'm gonna do my my Periscope video. Hello everybody, my name is Eric D. Johnson, also known by Shine right here in the city of Memphis, in the county sheriff in the state of Tennessee. Today and date is early Sunday morning, May 13, 2018, time 5:09 a.m. First day, thank all my fans, my support, for your continued encouragement and support. Anti-game. Anti-game. Now these are just a few free logo design websites you can go to and make anti-game logos. Continue to speak out, continue to complain about this nonsense. Talking about you want to be a thug, you want to be a gangster, you want to be a mobster, you want to be a goon, and you want to be a boss, and you know, you just want to be a criminal. You know, you don't want to do anything that's right. You know, you just want to kill people, rape people, and you know, you want to rob and steal and cheat. You want to be a criminal. You want to commit crimes. What we're going to do right now, we're going to, what time is it? But we're going to go to the Bible. Now we talk about these man-made religious organizations. For example, we know the Catholic Church is one of the oldest religions in the world, and you know, Catholic, when you say Catholic, that's Greek, so you know. But the man-made religious organizations, for example, the Catholic Church, and you know, all their Catholic churches, you know, the Church of England, the Eastern Orthodox churches, and all the Protestants, for example, all the Calvinists, all the Lutherans, Episcopalians, Presbyterians, Baptists, and their breakaway church, the Church of God in Christ, the Methodists, the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Seventh Day Adventists, the Mormons, the Amish, Mennonites, and we can go on, and all these cults, all these cults, and let's don't forget these groups, the Moorish Science Temple, the Nation of Islam, the 5% Nation, the Black Hebrew Israelites, the Rastafarians. We were talking about the FBI files. Everybody had the opportunity to go online and find the FBI files on the Moorish Science Temple talking about, and the Nation of Islam and the 5% Nation talking about, and the Black Hebrew Israelites and Rastafarians, W.W. Farr, Wallace Muhammad. And they got an FBI file on him. They say he was teaching. He was with the Moorish Science Temple at first. And after the Moorish Science Temple had that, all that stuff that happened with the Moorish Science Temple, and Noah Drew Ali died, and he got shot, and then he died, and then the Nation of Islam and Elijah Poole, and he was teaching him about Islam, supposedly. But they got an FBI file on him, and on all these organizations, on the Moorish Science Temple, on the Nation of Islam, on the 5% Nation. They got an FBI file on the Black Hebrew Israelites. They got an FBI file on the Rastafarians, the Garvey Movement. It's online. You can go online, or just go to FBI files, you will find exactly what you're looking for. And all that nonsense they be trying to teach people, a bunch of lies and man-made religious organizations. But all these man-made religious organizations, the Protestants, when you can go into the history books, they both been protesting the Catholic Church, supposedly. And then when you see the things that they do, then they break up and split up. Just like the American Restoration Movement, the Church of Christ. The American Restoration Movement. Because that's supposedly that's what they was trying to go back to. The church, when Jesus Christ established the church, Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 and 19. But you won't find a Church of Christ nowhere in Jerusalem. That's what apostles were at. But you don't find no evidence of the Church of Christ. Now, we know that the scientists be doing all this digging in the ground, and not just digging in the ground, because Jerusalem's still there. Jerusalem's still in Israel. Bethlehem is still in Israel, and so on and so forth. So if there's any evidence that they find, that's the evidence you have found. You can find evidence of the apostles. Because that's where the apostle was at, Jerusalem. That's where Jesus Christ was at, in Jerusalem. So all this stuff about Saul, he's a self-proclaimed apostle. All he's doing is lying. Excuse me. That's all these man-made religious organizations, like Scientology, they be lying. And so
we talk about Saul. One of the scriptures that the man-made religious organization used is Romans chapter 16, verse 16. Salute one another with the holy kiss. The churches, but no church with the suffix es of Christ salute. Another scripture that the man-made religious organization used, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 4. So that we ourselves glory you in the church with the suffix ES, churches of God, for your patience and faith and all your persecution and tribulation that ye endure. We're going to turn to the Bible. We're going to go to Acts chapter 1. Sure. We're in Acts chapter 1. Now, the reason why we go to Acts chapter 1, because we know that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now, he had been crucified. And after being crucified, he died on the cross. Now, we know that one of his disciples, Joseph of Arimathea, took his body down from the cross. And, you know, laid his body in the tomb. And the tomb was sealed. Jesus Christ was resurrected. And after he was resurrected, he had been seen. There have been reports in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There have been reports of Jesus Christ being seen, not just by his apostles. There were reports that people were seeing Jesus Christ after he died on the cross. Now, when you turn to the book of Acts, it says the same thing. The first chapter, chapter 1, the book of Acts, chapter 1. And we'll start reading. Verse number 1. The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he shewed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. Now we want to say this. People be saying they're Christian and know their Christianity. Jesus Christ was seen by his apostles after he was, you know, crucified and died on the cross and was resurrected. He was seen by his apostles that he chose for 40 days. 40 days Jesus Christ was seen by his apostles. Now, if you're supposed to be a Christian and Christianity and all this, the apostles, they never told you to be a Christian. They never told you to be a Christian. They never said that. You don't see anywhere where the apostles told you to be a Christian. Jesus Christ was seen by his apostles 40 days before. If you're supposed to be a Christian, Jesus Christ would have told his apostles to tell everybody to be a Christian. He was seen by his apostles 40 days. I'm going to keep reading. And speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. The apostle Paul, he claimed to be a self-proclaimed apostle. Jesus Christ told the apostle, do not depart from Jerusalem. What did he do?
True.
He went to Rome, Italy. He a self-proclaimed apostle. He not no apostle. He a self-proclaimed apostle. He lying. He lying. Jesus Christ in Acts chapter 1, verse number 4. And being assembled together with them, commanded, gave a commandment. He commanded his apostles, do not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which said, ye have heard of me, for John truly baptized with water, but ye should be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. But then, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, would thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfast toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel.
True.
Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, a 7 days' journey. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room whereby both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women, and Mary the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together were about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus. For he was known with us, and I obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder. In the midst of all his bowels gushed out. And it was known unto all dwellers at Jerusalem, and so much as that field is called in their proper name, tongue, a Aramaic, that is to say, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, let no man dwell therein. And his bishopric let another take. Wherefore these men, which are accompanied with us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that same day that he was taken up from us, must one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. And they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabas, who was surnamed Joseph, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, thou Lord, which knoweth the hearts of all men, shew whether of these two thou hast chosen, that they may take part of this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas, by transgression, failed, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Jesus spent 40 days with his apostles, and he commanded his apostles, do not depart from Jerusalem. It's in Acts chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Now, talking about being a Christian. Acts chapter 11, verse 26. Now we know that's the first place in the Bible that talking about being a Christian. Now the second place in the Bible is Acts chapter 26, verse 28. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuaded me to be a Christian. We know that's a lie. That's a lie. We know that Saul, the self-proclaimed, the self-proclaimed apostle Paul, he lied about his conversion. Now, as for being a Christian, we know that in Acts chapter 15, there was a meeting in Acts chapter 15, and all that stuff was put to rest. That was the end of it. After the apostles, the elders, and the whole church. That was the end of all that Christian stuff. That was the end of it. Now, the third place that you find talking about being a Christian is in 1 Peter chapter 4. Verse 16. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this path. When you read the scripture, this is 1 Peter, the apostle Peter. He's an apostle. Peter, apostle Peter, he is an apostle of Jesus Christ. Let me turn to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. Now, we done went over this before. But I want to say this again. Because everybody don't live in the same place. Everybody don't live in the same place. And stop taking it for granted. Because when people read this epistle, take for instance, let's put your mind back in a time during Peter's time, the apostle Peter's time, and he wrote this epistle. And then after he wrote this epistle was delivered so others could read. So when you say the first epistle of Peter, see, the people that know you, when they see the first epistle of Peter, you talking to the people that know you. Because when other people hear about this epistle, they ain't never met you before. So when you say the first epistle of Peter, the people that live in, for example, people that hadn't heard, they don't know who Peter is. They don't know who Peter is, and telling me, saying all this stuff. In this epistle, they don't know who you are. But see, when you say the first epistle of Peter, Peter is capitalized in bold writing. People know who you are. So first of all, I'm talking to the people that know me, the other apostles. First of all, the other apostle. When you say Peter, the other apostles gonna read the epistle. They know who Peter, no, the first epistle of Peter. The other apostles know you. And then you're gonna have to tell these people in chapter 1, verse number 1. Peter again, Peter capitalized, Peter. The other apostles and all those and the elders of the church in Jerusalem and you know, people who know you. Then an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now you telling people you are an apostle of who? Jesus Christ. Now you got people who are not only apostles, but now you dealing with the Romans, the Jews, because you said Jesus Christ. Before he was crucified, there's a lot of people heard about Jesus Christ. It's a lot of people know Jesus Christ, you know, they didn't heard. Because remember, the fame of Jesus Christ went to, Galilee, Decapolis, and beyond Jordan. So Jesus Christ has been heard of beyond Jordan. But when it comes to Peter, everybody beyond Jordan don't know who Peter is. So you got to tell, I'm Peter. Now all those who know close, all the apostles, they know me. I'm Peter. They know I'm Peter. That's who write. An apostle. See, when you say you're an apostle, they put you in a different category in the church. In the church, when you say apostle, it's a select few. You were chosen by Jesus. So in the church, when you say Peter, that's saying one thing. But when you say an apostle, the title apostle is not applied to everybody. It's a select few, those who were chosen by Jesus Christ. So in the church, when people in the church hear an apostle, they know you were taught by Jesus Christ. You know you're not recognized like everybody else, like the elders. But see, the elders were chosen by the apostles. But the apostles were chosen by Jesus Christ. And when you're talking about the church, that's saying something. That's saying something. You're an apostle. You knew Jesus. You knew Jesus Christ. You walked with Jesus Christ. You were taught by Jesus Christ about the kingdom of God. Spent 40 days when Jesus Christ was crucified and rose from the dead. Spent 40 days with Jesus Christ after he was resurrected. You're an apostle. You're Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now when other people hear about an apostle of Jesus Christ, what they heard you say, it wasn't an apostle, but they heard you say Jesus Christ, because you're an apostle of Jesus Christ. People beyond Jordan, they heard about Jesus Christ, and you one of his apostles. You one of his apostles. You one of Jesus Christ as apostle. So you wrote this epistle. And so now them people reading your epistle. So let's turn back. To Acts chapter 4. Verse number 16. So now we establish who wrote this epistle. And then people trying to accuse Apostle Peter of telling you to be a Christian. You misinterpreted the scripture. That's a misinterpretation. That's a misinterpretation of the scripture. The Apostle Peter not telling you to be no Christian. He's telling you that there are people walking around lying. That they were lying. And these are the instructions on how to address this issue. If any man, see, that what he's trying to tell you. If any man, if any man, what are you saying when you say if any? You done just put everybody, that can be anybody. That can be anybody on this earth. People you ain't never seen before. Including the people who are going around lying. Because you suffer. The people that go around lying, they suffer. They need prayer. If any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. Who talking? Apostle Peter. If any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed. Why, if they told you to be a Christian, why would I have to tell you not to be ashamed? If you saying, you claim that the Apostle Peter told you to be a Christian, why would he turn around and tell you not to be ashamed? I'm an apostle. I'm the one, since you claim that the Apostle Peter told you to be a Christian, why he going to turn around and tell you not to be ashamed? Because that's not what the scripture means. You misinterpret the scripture. The Apostle Peter telling you, if any man suffer as a Christian, that what you're doing, you're suffering. You've been lied to. You've been lied to. And when people lie to you, you suffer. Think about your everyday life. How somebody can lie to you. A man and a woman get married. For example. Man, woman, they get married. Man lied to his wife. Wife lied to her husband. You think you ain't gonna suffer? You ain't suffering? When you find out the truth? When a man lied to his wife? When the wife find out the truth? You think she ain't suffering? You think she wasn't already suffering? But then when she find out the truth, when the wife lied to her husband, the husband was suffering with this woman that's been lying to him. Then the husband find out the truth. See, you misinterpret the scripture. You misinterpret the scripture. The Apostle Peter didn't tell you to be no Christian. He wasn't telling you to be no Christian. He knew there were people going around lying. There were people going around lying. That's the reason why he said, if any man, including the people that were going around lying. If any man, because you're suffering. You suffering because you've been lied to, and you think you can go around and lie to somebody else. You suffering as a Christian. You suffering. You don't know the truth. You don't know the truth. Let them not be ashamed, but let them glorify God on this behalf. The Apostle Peter gave you instruction on what to do about being lied to and lying. Now, let me turn back over here. Also, 2 Peter. Chapter 3. 2 Peter. Chapter 3. Verses 15, 16, 17, 18. The Apostle Peter exposed Saul from Tarsus. He was exposed. He was exposed for lying. Those epistles that Saul wrote, the Apostle Peter exposed Saul from Tarsus, the self-proclaimed Apostle Paul, for lying. All those epistles that Saul wrote, they all lies. He a self-proclaimed apostle. He not no apostle. He a self-proclaimed apostle. He not no apostle. Now, when it comes to the lies that Saul told, that was one of them about being a Christian. Now, let me turn over here. Okay, we know that Saul converted, Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. And then we turn over to Acts chapter 22. Saul tells about his conversion. He lied. He lied about his conversion. One of the lies we go to. Acts chapter 22, verse number 9. And they that were with me saw indeed the light, and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spoke to me. That's one of the lies. That's one lie. There are a lot of lies in Acts chapter 22 that Saul from Tarsus, the self-proclaimed Apostle Paul, tell. That's one of the lies. Now let's turn over to Acts chapter 26. Paul recounts his conversion. He lied again. He lied again. And we can go straight to it. Verses 13, 14, and 15. He lied. He lied. Now, this is the end of it. All this stuff talking about being a Christian, this is the reason why this is the end of it. This is the end of it. Like I said, that was the end of it. Acts chapter 15, verse 22. That was the end of that Christian stuff. That was the end of it. And, you know, we talk about all these man-made religious organizations. You see how we read the Bible. What you gonna prove? You see how we open the Bible. We went to 1 Peter, 2 Peter. We went to the book of Acts. We go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. What you gonna prove? You're not gonna prove nothing. You're not gonna prove anything. That's the reason why we continue to talk about history. The American Restoration Movement. The Protestant Movement. You open up the Bible, you ain't gonna prove nothing. The Catholic Church. What you gonna prove? You see all them scientists over there at the university? They study DNA and carbon dating system. Then they digging in the ground all over the earth. They been all over Europe digging, they in Asia digging, they in the Middle East digging, they in Africa digging. They finding bones all over the earth. And then when they after they find these bones, they are they trying to determine the age of the bones. Some of the bones they done found all over the earth over a million years old. And you gonna open up the Bible, what you gonna prove? They finding handwriting, they finding all kind of artwork in caves, on rocks, all over the earth. Just like when I did my shoot, for example, I've been talking about my DNA. I got my DNA done through family tree DNA, and they were talking about they told me about the trace results, and they were talking about the American and Central America, the Indians, the Native American, 2%. Then, the scientists have been digging all over the earth. They have found all these Clovis points. Then when they do the testing and to determine the age of bones and all the type of tools they find, it'd be all over 1,000 years, over 10,000, over 100,000 years old. It's all over the earth that the scientists are digging, finding all these pots, and even in the water, under in the sea, they finding records of people that lived on this earth. And we didn't even start talking about the dinosaurs and the bones they found from the different animal life that's been on this earth. Millions of years old. And then you think you're going to open up the Bible and you're going to prove the American Restoration Movement is right. The Church of Christ is right. You're going to open up the Bible. You're going to prove that the Protestant, John Calvin, know what he was talking about. Martin Luther, you need to get somewhere and sit down. You ain't prove anything. The Catholic Church gonna prove that they right. Well, if they were gonna prove they were right, then the scientists still did. Because you haven't proved anything. You haven't proved that you was right. And all this digging ain't a Catholic Church not gonna prove they right. And then they'll start talking about the Jews and everybody else. Talking about opening up the Bible, you gonna prove what you saying is right. continue talking about African traditional religion. And African traditional religion is being taught at colleges and universities in sub-Saharan Africa. You can earn a master's degree, you can earn a PhD studying African traditional religion. Now, one of the books we're going to continue to read and refer to is titled West African Traditional Religion, written by Dr. Joseph Obasanjo Balelu, Dr. P. Adelumo Dupeyemi. Another book we're going to continue to read and refer to is titled African Traditional Religion, A Definition, written by Dr. E. Eloja Adonwu. Another book we're going to continue to read and refer to is titled African Religion and Philosophy, written by Dr. John S. M. B. Another book we're going to continue to read and refer to is titled Concepts of God in Africa, written by Dr. John S. M. B. Examples of schools in, you know, in sub-Saharan Africa that teach African traditional religion. Dr. Joseph Obasanjo Balelu, PhD, Abidjan, senior lecturer, African traditional religion, Department of Religious Studies, University of Abidjan, Nigeria. Another example of a school that teach African traditional religion, Dr. P. Adelumo Dupeyemi, PhD, Abidjan, Department of Religious Studies, University of Aloran, Nigeria. Now then there's another school in Nigeria, the Open University of Nigeria. They teach African traditional religion, the Open University of Nigeria. Now, Dr. E. Eloja Adonwu, Professor of Religious Studies, University, Abidjan, Nigeria. Dr. John S. M. Beta, he was born in Kenya and he studied at Makerere University College in Uganda. Now, like I said, you know, there was examples of school. There's some more school in sub-Saharan Africa that teach African traditional religion. Now, you know, we continue to speak out and complain about this nonsense. Talking about you want to be a gangster, a mobster. Talking about you want to be a goon, you want to be a thug. You know, you want to be a boss and all this. You want to be a criminal. You want to commit crimes. You want to commit murder, rape, robbery, steal, cheat. You don't want to do what's right. It's going to lead to anti-gang demonstration, anti-gang protest. Now, you know, the German government told the United States government anti-gang. That's what the United States government consulted with the German government. The German government told the United States government anti-gang. Not putting up with that nonsense. It's wrong. And not gonna put up with it. And they don't. Now, the United States government passed a law, the Organized Crime Control Act of 1970. Title IX of the Organized Crime Control Act of 1970 is the Racketeer Influence and Corrupt Organization. Corrupt Organization Act, the RICO Act. And also the Comprehensive Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Act of 1970, Controlled Substance Act, Psychotropic Substance Act, Continued Criminal Enterprise Statute, Kingpin Statute. It's anti-gang. It's anti-gang. You know, just like we were talking about the motorcycle gang, the Hells Angels, and their rivals, the mongrels. No, that's wrong. That's not right. The apple dumpling gang. What they call Jesse James and Frank James gang. The Dalton gang. Going around robbing banks and just committing all kind of crimes. You're a criminal. It's wrong. The Alpha Dumpling gang. Fat Alvin and the gang. It's wrong. That's not right. It's wrong. It's wrong. Now, the Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention Act of 1974 established the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, plus other related legislation. The Comprehensive Anti-Gang Initiative, Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, and Comprehensive Gang Model, the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, the Bureau of Justice Assistance, the Office of Justice Program, and the United States Department of Justice, Office of Justice Program, Bureau of Justice Assistance, the United States Department of Justice. Comprehensive Anti-Gang Initiative Project Safe Neighborhood. United States Department of Justice, Office of Community Oriented Police and Service, Comprehensive Anti-Gang Initiative, Office of Juvenile Justice and Links Prevention, United States Department of Justice, Office of Justice Program, Bureau of Justice Assistance, International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs, United States Department of State, Institute for Intergovernmental Affairs, Gang Resistance Education and Training, a great program. The United States Department of Justice, Office of Justice Program, the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention. We also do that now, the National Youth Gang Center, which has been funded by the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention since 1995, merged with the National Gang Center, which has been funded by the Bureau of Justice Assistance since 2003. National Gang Center. Compilation of state laws against gang. Gang prevention overview of research program, Mr. James Howe, the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention. United States Department of Justice, Bureau of Justice Assistance, Office of Juvenile Justice and Links Prevention, the National Gang Center Bulletin. In the title of their book, History of Street Gangs in the United States, read the books in the bulletin. And also, you can go to Wikipedia, and you'll find the same information type of gangs in the United States. The United States Department of Justice, Office of the United States Attorney, man, 1457, Criminal Street Gang Statute 18, United States Code 521. The United States Department of Justice, Federal Bureau Investigating the FBI, National Gang Intelligence Center. The German government, use your common sense. When you say National Gang Intelligence, the German government told the United States government, anti-gang. The United States Department of Justice, Organized Crime and Gang Section, and other federal, state, and local agencies. The United States Department of Justice, Office of Justice Program, National Institute of Justice, Anti-Gang Strategies, Prevention, Intervention, Assessment, and Suppression. The United States Department of Justice, Office of Justice Program, National Institute of Justice, United States Department of Health and Human Services, Center for Disease Control and Prevention, National Center for Injury Prevention and Control, Changing Course, Preventing Gang Membership, and also striving to reduce youth violence everywhere. The United States Department of Justice, United States Department of Education, United States Department of Health and Human Services, United States Department of Housing and Urban Development, United States Department of Labor, and the White House Office on National Drug Control Policy, National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention. Forum. You can go to youth.gov, be informed about the National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention, as well as the Comprehensive Anti-Gang Initiative and the Comprehensive Gang Model. United States Department of Justice, Bureau of Justice, National Crime Prevention Council, keeping kids out of gangs, and also anti-hazing. You can go to lawyers.com, be informed about anti-hazing. Don't forget these words: coercion, sexual coercion, psychological coercion, psychological manipulation, psychological abuse. Say we're gonna continue to speak out about this nonsense, so-called being a gangster and a mobster. You know, a lot of people know, like we said, when we were looking at the dictionary, the online dictionary. You know, like Merriam-Webster's online dictionary, Oxford University dictionary, dictionary.com. Cambridge University, they got the dictionary online, and then Oxford University, then we got Macmillan,
named Millen, and there was one more that come. Collins dictionary online. And you know, a lot of people in the avenue, you know, everybody don't live here in the United States of America or in Canada, Mexico, the Caribbean. Everybody don't live in the same place. Everybody don't live in Europe. Everybody don't live in Africa. Everybody don't live in Asia. Everybody don't live in the Pacific Islands. You know, everybody don't live in the same place. Everybody don't look the same. Everybody don't speak the same language. Everybody, you know, people's cultures and customs, traditions. Now, talking about being a gangster and a mobster, like I said, a lot of people in the African American community, illiterate, uneducated, didn't even know what a syllable break was. Talking about a gangster, gang plus stir, mob plus stir. Didn't even know what a syllable break was or is. You know, just being realistic. You know, even today, because you know many African Americans were denied education. You know, it's a fact. Denied education, including me. You know, for a long time, it took people having to protest and, you know, to be able to put African Americans in school and then the quality of their education. You know. So going around being a criminal, that's what you've been taught, to be a criminal. Going around saying you're a thug and you're a goon and you're a boss and you're a gang cluster and mob cluster. You're a criminal. I'm a pimp, I'm a whore, and you know, I'm a player, I'm a Mac, and you know, all these street slang words. You know, we talk about the East Coast being a gang base here in the United States of America. You know, the East African, West African slave trade. Slaves brought to America, to the East Coast. But then those other slave ports, Mississippi, New Orleans, Louisiana, Galveston, Texas, and Veracruz, Mexico, they were slave ports as well. But we know that the East Coast, the gang base, and they nonsense, you know, some nonsense. Gonna continue to speak out and complain. People making gang videos in Chicago. People making gang videos in Los Angeles, California. The sorority and the fraternity, celebrity athletes and celebrity entertainers being in a gang. Leaving the United States of America, going outside this country. The U.S. military, foreign service, for example, the Peace Corps, and also foreign service. You know, government jobs like the Peace Corps. And then you have these charitable organizations, for example, the Red Cross, Red Crescent Society. The sorority and the fraternity, business, people being business, the sorority and the fraternity, as well as, you know, criminals. And, you know, something that reminded me when we be talking about, you know, people being on a job and the management, you know, the managers, and you know what came to my mind? You know, everybody that's in management don't have a degree. Let's just say a fast food restaurant. The people that, you know, the managers, you know, the manager at a fast food restaurant, they started out as a cook, you know, working at the cash register. and then moved up to assistant manager, then manager. And then, you know, on from there. But then you have those other managers who have a degree, associate's degree, bachelor's degree, master's degree, PhD, so on and so forth. You know? But like I said, all the managers don't have no degree. You know, you have people that are in management that are assistant managers and managers, like at a convenience store. You know, people that work at a convenience store, they the manager. They don't have no degree, but they the manager. Then you have those below, you know, under the manager. But like I said, you had the manager, assistant manager, and manager. And then you had, you know, the people who have the social degree, master's degree, PhD. And let me see, convenience stores, restaurants, different jobs and things where people who are, they are managers, but they don't have no associate degree, they don't have no bachelor's degree, but they are a manager, they're assistant managers and managers. So when it comes to the sorority and the fraternity, see, this is what the criminal street gang. This is what the criminal street gang. Then you have the sorority and the fraternity. See, this is what we're talking about. How the sorority and the fraternity and the criminal street gang, they depend on the sorority and the fraternity. And the sorority and the fraternity, they depend on the criminal street gang. So when you be on your job, you know you be at work. You know, if you say you ain't want to be in no gang, or you ain't want to be in no sorority fraternity, see, this is how they coerce, the coercion force you to be a part of that nonsense. So we're gonna continue to speak out and complain. And it's gonna be anti-gang demonstration and anti-gang protest. Now, like I said, I encourage everyone that's watching my Periscope, my YouTube, as well as my Facebook video, to read the International Bill of Human Rights, as well as the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Also, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. The Declaration of the Rights of the Child. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child.
Okay, that was anti-slavery international. Now this is the International Federation for Human Rights. Also, Fauna and Flora International. The International Union for Conservation of Nature, and also the World Wildlife Fund. And also, you know, Amnesty International. Amnesty International. Well, we know the history. We know the history of Amnesty International. He was a lawyer in the United Kingdom. And there were two Portuguese students who were protesting. And also, we know the history of Human Rights Watch and Helsinki Watch. I mean, you know, we know the history of a lot of organizations around the world, and we continue to build momentum, anti-gang demonstration, anti-gang protest, and we know it's coming, day coming. We know it's going to take time, you know, to inform, you know, educate and inform people all over the earth, you know, anti-slavery. International is informing, educating myself as well as others about modern day slavery. You know what I'm saying? You know, being specific, you know, slavery and then modern day slavery. You know what I'm saying? Child trafficking, you know, child marriage, and human trafficking, bonded labor, I had to go to the website. I know there's six different categories, you know. But, you know, we all being educated and informed about modern day slavery. And we know that the sorority and fraternities and, you know, the criminal street gang, they behind, you know, they involved. And they participate in these, these crimes against humanity. They be involved. You know, when we talk about the environment, a bird like international, fauna and flora, like we've been saying, no, there's no one person that's doing all this. That you got to have all these organizations. You got to have bird like international. You got to have fauna and flora. You understand? You got to have the International Union for the Conservation. You got to have all these organizations. It's not a one person that's doing all this. No. It's a lot of criminals that's committing human rights violations. that's violating that environment. It's not no one person, it's a lot of criminals committing crimes, no human rights violations. Committing crimes against the environment. There's a lot of criminals. And it's going to, you know, we're going to have to inform, we got to educate and inform the general public worldwide about a lot of things, because sometimes people don't, you know you're accused of being a criminal. And some people with PhDs, some people with master's degree, they think they're smarter than everybody else. They think they can make you be a criminal, make you commit a crime without you realizing that it's a human rights violation. Let's just take paper, trash. If you hadn't have been educated and informed on what to do with paper, trash. If you didn't think that there was nothing wrong with, with throwing paper on the ground, that's because everybody used paper around the world. If you didn't think there was nothing wrong with throwing paper on the ground and just leaving it there, you had to be educated and informed that when you throw paper on the ground, you polluting. You pollute the ground. Not only the ground, but the water and the earth. You have to be educated and informed about that paper. Because first of all, you don't know what the paper is made. You don't know the materials that were involved. You don't know that they went down and cut some trees. You don't know all the facts about the paper. You had to be educated and informed about paper. Then once you became educated and informed about paper, then you stopped doing the things that you were doing at first. But see, somebody with a master's degree, somebody with a PhD in business, in government, it took, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. It took Bird Life International. It took Fauna and Flora to educate and inform. It took Anti-Slavery International. It took the International Federation for Human Rights to educate and inform all of us about paper. Because before you was educated and informed about paper, all of us were committing a human rights violation. All of us. You didn't even know you were committing a human rights violation. You didn't know it was quote unquote a human rights violation with paper. What was that phrase? Being politically correct. When you hear somebody on the radio or the television say human rights violation, they telling you what to say. You ain't even know what to say. But when you hear somebody human rights violation, environmental, violation, you ain't know what to say or how to address. When you heard it on the radio, when you heard it on the television, when you read it in the newspaper, read it in the magazine, I'm included. You didn't know what human rights violation was. Especially when it comes to the environment. Because the way we was taught, the environment is one thing, and human rights, that's like somebody putting you in jail. Like the government, they throw you in jail and for a crime you didn't commit, and then you do a DNA test and just say, a man get thrown in jail. for alleged crime, murder, rape. Then they do a DNA test. Then you get released from jail. That's human rights. That's what we was taught. But when it comes to the environment, it's just like a plastic bottle. We didn't think that was like human rights. A plastic bottle, plastic bag. We had to be taught that was human rights. The animals, let's just say the animals. We had to be taught. That's another thing about human rights and about somebody with a master's degree and a PhD. People committing crimes against the animals. The elephants, the rhinoceros, you had to be taught. You had to be taught to even curl. Some people didn't even curl. And we still had to educate and inform people about the animals. Because if you don't, people won't care. They don't see why, they don't see how this affects me. The insects, the ants, the bumblebee. We didn't think it was important until you found out about how the bumblebee pollinate they pollinate the flowers and how important the bumblebees are to our survival. You had to be taught by Fauna and Flora International, by BirdLife International, by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. You had to be taught, and the World Wildlife Fund, you had to be taught that the flowers were important and the bumblebee was important. The water is important. The air you breathe is important. Think about all the people who smoke cigarettes. And then you heard somebody say, and the people who don't smoke cigarettes, you heard somebody say, secondhand smoke. You ain't never heard nothing. You ain't even know nothing about nothing like that. But you read in a newspaper, in a magazine, you watched, you heard on the radio, you watch television, and what they say? They say secondhand smoke. Somebody just like me, I don't smoke cigarettes. I ain't never liked cigarettes, but I heard secondhand smoke. You had to be educated and informed about the dangers of cigarette smoke to people who don't smoke. It wasn't just cigarettes can kill the people who smoke. It's people who don't smoke. That's the reason why today, when you be on your job, what they got to do now? You can't even smoke cigarettes at work. You got to have a designated smoking area on your job. Because why? Secondhand smoke. But see, you had to be taught. See, the people who smoke cigarettes, they didn't think it was a big deal. You had to be taught. See, somebody with a master's degree, somebody with a PhD, the sorority and the fraternity, see, they violate human rights. But somebody at Anti-Slavery International, the people at Anti-Slavery International, the people at the International Federation for Human Rights, they had to stand up. So people wouldn't die from secondhand smoke. And not just human beings, but also the animals. You throw cigarette butts everywhere. You ain't think about that, did you? When the people get through smoking cigarette, what they do with the cigarette butts? They just throw them on the ground. They had to stop people from doing that. Because the animals. You leave your cigarette butt out there on the ground. The birds, the dogs, and the cats. You leave all your waste just out there on the ground. forward, we're going to continue to speak out and complain. We're going to continue to build momentum, anti-gang demonstration, anti-gang protest. Let me go over here right fast. DNA test, and it was the family tree DNA. Now let me see. Okay, there you go. My result came back. It was like 69% African, 61% West African, 6% East Central African. 2% South Central Africa, and then 29% European, 18% the British Isles, 7% Eastern Europe, 4% Iberian Peninsula. Then no trace results. 1% Northeast Asia. Now over there, in China, the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region, and now North Xinjiang, you know, there's Tibetan Buddhists in North Xinjiang, South Xinjiang, the Tarim Basin, the Turkic Uyghur people. Now that's where the DNA was found. Now you know the Han Chinese, they also in the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region. Now, if you don't know the history of Xinjiang, the Tarim Basin, or the Indo-European Tartarians, you know, they also in history lived in Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region. Now, the Indo-European Tartarians, they intermixed with the Turkic Uyghur people. Now, also the Indo-Iranian, the Sakai, they also lived in Xinjiang, the Uyghur Autonomous Region. Central America, there were 2%. Now, the North and Central America cluster consists of present-day native populations spanning from southeastern Alaska down through the western half of the United States and end at the top of Nicaragua. Population within this cluster are descended from the first migration from Siberia that moved into the Americas via the Beringian land bridge roughly 15,000-23,000 years ago. This cluster split roughly 13,000 years ago as one splinter group migrated east and south to populate areas of North and Central America, and the second group spread down to South America, subsisting largely as nomadic hunter-gatherers. The first people of Northern America are commonly understood via the Clovis people, who use their uniquely fluted projectile points, claw pointed tools to hunt the megafaunae, such as mammoths, saber-toothed cats, land sloths, and any camel that were present in North America at the end of the Pleistocene Ice Age. And later populations such as the Hohokam Society in the Southwest. In the current day, Phoenix display evidence for increased social complaints, likely due to the use of irrigation management technology, and so on and so forth. Now,
Atkins map. That's how I found all these markers all over the place. DNA over there in Indonesia, Suriname, Java, Timor. Western Europe, you know, France, Belgium, Germany. Italy. Then like I said, all of Eastern Europe, Poland, and Slovakia, Hungary, Romania, Slovenia, Greece. Then Canada, Venezuela, Cuba, Mexico. Let me click over there. Okay. The ancestral origin. Bolivia, Galatia, Estonia, Jordan, Kuwait, that's the Afro-Asiatic. South Africa, Turkey, Ukraine. Let me check back over there. ancestral origins that we know. Now over here, that is Angola, Cape Verde, Chad, there's what? Some Nilo-Saharan, the Sayray. Ethiopia, that's Afro-Asiatic. Niger Congo, Gambia, Ghana, Togo, Guinea-Bissau, Haiti, Israel, Jamaica, Liberia, that's Niger Congo, Libya, Afro-Asiatic, Mauritania, Afro-Asiatic, Morocco, Afro-Asiatic, Nigeria, Niger Congo, Sierra Leone, it's Niger Congo, Trinidad and Tobago, Turkey, St. Vincent and Grenadines. Puerto Rico. Suriname, but there's Suriname. Yeah. Alright. So let's go to the dictionary.
Now we know the prefixes, suffixes, and root words. They in Merriam-Webster's Third New International Dictionary and Oxford English Dictionary. Webster's Third New International Dictionary, the complete definition of meaning of the word gang, the act, mental meaning of going. Mobile. the mob. The stupid sorority, the stupid fraternity, this is sister. This is brother.
I ain't finished yet.
Huh?
Let me finish.
Oh, okay. Okay. I don't know if you're going to lay back down, set the clock to wake up when you... Okay. I'm laying back down for a few minutes. Thank you.
listed Oxford in the dictionary. The complete definition and meaning of the word game. Action or mode of going, way, passage, a set of things or persons. Logos, you know, you go to free logo designs, and these are just a few of the websites, just a few anti-gang logos. Get ready to end today's video, and we're gonna continue to speak out and complain about the nonsense. Talking about you a thug and you a goon, you a boss, you a gang cluster and a mob cluster. You know, you a pimp, you a whore, you a Mac, you a player. All that street slang, you know. It's just a bunch of, it's not enough. You're a criminal. You're a criminal. And, you know, it's going to lead to anti-gang demonstrating, anti-gang protests. People coming on the job, coming to work, trying to coerce other employees, whether it's management or non-management. You know, anti-gang demonstrating, anti-gang protest. Again, they always put God first. Again, my name is Eric D. Johnson, also known by Shiny, right here in the city of Minnesota, County Sheriff in the state of Tennessee. And thank all my fans, my support for your continued caring and support. And I know that here in the United States of America is Mother's Day. So, you know, wish everybody a happy Mother's Day. And take care of yourself. Wish each and every one of you very best.